Hello everyone, my name is Paul Comerford. I'm a Principal Technology Advisor at the ICO, and today I'm going to talk about anonymization, pseudonymization, and privacy enhancing technologies, also known as PETs. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the ICO's view of anonymization and pseudonymization and the approach that we're taking with our guidance. I'm going to talk a bit about personal data and how controllers should determine whether data is personal or not. And part of that is the reasonably likely test and something called the spectrum of identifiability. We'll also look at privacy enhancing technologies and some of the benefits and risks that they present. And lastly, I'll talk about plans for our upcoming guidance. So a lot has changed since 2012 when we released our original anonymization code of practice. The most obvious change is the UK GDPR introduction in 2018. We also have the emergence of new privacy enhancing technologies, the emergence of synthetic data, which was certainly not around in 2012, new data sources from things like Internet of Things devices, wearables and so on. Obviously, lots more data that has potential to be anonymized. We have the Data Protection Act 2018 re-identification offence, which was introduced to prevent organisations from maliciously re-identifying data. And we have new identification techniques. We see in academia more advanced techniques to re-identify individuals, and this is a fast-changing environment. So firstly, we need to look at what is personal data. This is data that identifies an individual, and it can be direct identification or indirect identification. Direct identification will be something like a name or an email address, whereas indirect is where you have to link the information with something else to identify an individual. And sometimes this can be far from clear cut, and you need to analyze the data carefully to determine whether that data is identifiable or not. And you have to look at whether re-identification is reasonably likely, as it says in the GDPR. And also when you're determining whether data is personal or not, you need to determine whether it relates to an individual. And to do this, you need to look at the content of the information, what purpose you're processing it for, and whether that information would have a likely impact or effect on the individual when it was processed. The key thing to note is that information that is truly anonymous and is completely non-identifiable is not covered under the UK GDPR. So we see in the media anonymization and pseudonymization crop up a lot, particularly in the last 12 months with the COVID-19 pandemic. It was in the news with contact tracing. The contact tracing app was considered to be anonymous. The 2021 census statistics released need to be anonymized. IoT analytics from wearable devices, smart home devices, all these need to be anonymized. Healthcare data that's shared between GPs and hospitals needs to be anonymized or pseudonymized. So we see this crop up a lot, but there's often confusion between some of the terms like anonymization and pseudonymization. So let's start with pseudonymized data. Pseudonymized data is mentioned throughout the GDPR, and it's a good privacy safeguard. It provides security and reduces privacy risk because it hides the identity of individuals. And it's defined in UK GDPR under Article 4.5. It basically says that pseudonymized data is data that can't be re-identified without combining that data with other information that's held separately within the organization. And there's controls around that data to prevent that data being joined maliciously. The key thing is, though, that pseudonymized data is not anonymized. It's still personal data under GDPR, so the GDPR rules still apply to that data. There are some caveats to that, however, because pseudonymized data under some circumstances may be considered anonymized, but that will depend strongly on the case involved and whether re-identification is reasonably likely. I'll talk more about that in a moment. So moving on now to the reasonably likely test, this is one of the tests that is used within the GDPR to determine whether a piece of data is identifiable for a particular individual. And it requires the data controller to determine whether there are means reasonably likely that could be used to single out an individual, for example, either directly or indirectly. And they need to consider certain factors like how much it would cost, how much time it would take, and what technology is available at the time. And this is a moving target because, of course, technology advances and we need to consider what is state of the art and keep up to date with technological developments. Another thing we need to consider is how identifiability of data is measured. Identifiability is of course, across a spectrum. And you can see on the left, the lady there is completely identifiable. And as you move to the right, the identifiability gets less to a point where you can't single out that individual anymore from a group. And there are various ways of representing this. And we've seen in the literature, various models for representing identifiability, but none of these are align really with the GDPR. So we've been working on a identifiability spectrum model, which closely aligns with the GDPR. And this is our latest thinking on that. So you can see on the left-hand side, an individual placed in that category would be directly identifiable. So the data might contain their names and addresses. You know, it's very straightforward to identify those individuals. And as you progress to the right-hand side of that spectrum, the effort required to re-identify gets harder and harder. So within the yellow and the orange parts, that data is still personal data under GDPR, but it becomes less identifiable. There's more controls around the data. Some of the identifiers might have been removed, but that is still personal data because it's still individual level data. As you move into the red sections, then the data is no longer identifiable. Usually that's data that's aggregated at a higher level and no one could be singled out from that data. So for example, this could be people within a large group and you can't single out an individual. And once you get into that category, the red category, it's outside of the scope of the GDPR. Now I'm going to move on now to talk a little bit about privacy enhancing technologies, which have come a long way within the last few years, particularly large organizations like Google and Apple are developing these alongside other organizations, smaller organizations. One of the first ones I want to talk about is homomorphic encryption. This is a special form of encryption that allows computation on encrypted data, but you don't have to actually decrypt the data. It remains encrypted throughout the entire life cycle of the data. And of course, this provides many advantages because no intruder could actually see that data. It remains encrypted. Differential privacy adds noise to statistics, and this can be very useful in things like census statistic information release, where you don't want anyone singled out within that data. You can add noise to that data so that no one can be seen. Secure multi-party computation is another technique whereby multiple parties can privately provide an input to a computation without seeing the inputs from the other parties. They remain hidden. Trusted execution environments are parts of a CPU which are completely isolated from the other parts of the CPU and the operating system of a computer or a mobile phone. So those computations can be done without revealing information to other code within the operating system. And federated learning is a technique where the computation is distributed among many different computers or devices so that no party can see the entire computation. Firstly, why would we want to use PETs? What benefits do they offer over processing data without them? Well, firstly, they reduce security risk, particularly because they hide information so that adversaries can't access that information. They provide data protection by design if implemented correctly, which is a key requirement for the GDPR. And along with that, they provide data minimization because only the minimum amount of information is shared or none at all in some cases. That's one downside of processing in the clear, is obviously sensitive information might be shared. They might facilitate sharing across different borders, across the EU and other jurisdictions, but they may reduce data accuracy. And this is particularly important when you're adding noise to data. The more noise you add, the less accurate it gets. And lastly, one of the things you need to consider is whether the data that you're processing is identifiable. And that comes back to my earlier point about assessing whether that data is indirectly identifiable, directly identifiable, or whether it's anonymous. So as part of our work, we are working closely with organizations such as the NHS to develop relevant case studies. So healthcare is one of the key areas that we're looking at. Also finance, location data, which can be very difficult to anonymize, and also Internet of Things data, analytics, information, which often requires anonymization. Lastly, I'd like to talk about ICO anonymization and pseudonymization and PETS guidance that we're working on throughout this year. The guidance will help organizations clarify the differences between anonymization and pseudonymization, which is one of the key things that organizations need to consider. It will be structured in such a way that organizations will be able to determine that the level of identifiability within their data processing operations using that spectrum approach and the reasonably likely test. And we're going to use suitable case studies from various sectors that I've described earlier that will demonstrate best practices on how anonymization, pseudonymization should be done, and how to determine the level of identifiability. So this is a complementary piece to the ICO data sharing code, and it will consider the technical and organizational measures that need to be in place, particularly with those case studies. We've recently released a blog on the ICO website a couple of weeks ago, which provides some more information on our plans and the various phases as we move through that guidance. So check that out, and we will provide you the link for that. I'd like to thank you for listening. And if you have any more queries or questions about what I've just presented, then please get in touch with us. Thank you.